Joining us for his take on the markets, John Mangun. He is a market columnist. Hi, John. Good morning. Great to have you back.
Good morning, Michelle. The highlight of my week.
Oh, wonderful. I hope this is going to be an exciting conversation. I hope to hear some good news. Do you have good news for us?
No, I have good news. I have bad news. The good news is the market's not going down. The bad news is the market's not going up.
Okay. And so with a market just, you know, ranging within a very small range, is that a good thing? Considering the realities, because, I mean, John, if you look at other markets, the U.S. appears to be winning, you know, this battle against COVID because of vaccines. China's looking pretty fantastic. Things are improving in Europe. They're catching up. I mean, how much longer should Philippine investors have to wait to be able to join the positive bunch?
Well, let's be realistic. The U.S. market is going up because the Federal Reserve keeps printing money, printing money, printing money. That's mm-hmm. to be expected. As far as Europe goes, nobody cares, to be very honest with you. Because you have all these little regional markets in Europe, or these national markets. Look, here's the deal on the Philippine stock market. The market's been asleep for 5 weeks. However, we have stayed above the 50-day moving average line. And nobody wants to be the first one to sell down because prices aren't going down. And no one wants to be the first one to buy up because prices aren't going up. Mm-hmm. Now, as far as the situation with the COVID, we're running up against what's happening in a lot of other countries. And that is absolute frustration with the lockdown. We have heard continuously for the last 12 months, one more lockdown, one more lockdown. This is going to be the one that's going to stop it. It hasn't worked. And now the experts, I think there's as many experts on COVID in the Philippines as there is active COVID cases. Mm-hmm. Now the argument is, well, you know, 6 months ago or 3 months ago or a year ago, we should have had a longer lockdown. Hey, if I'd have married my high school sweetheart, whose father was a multimillionaire, never mind.
Okay, so
hindsight's a waste of time.
So John, I know that in one of your recent articles, you said that you are seeing a glimmer of light at the end of this economic tunnel. I guess my question is, how long do you think it's going to take to get us from where we are to that light? Are you expecting, for example, improving markets significantly by the third quarter of this year, by the fourth quarter of this year? What's your time horizon?
I don't have a time horizon because I do not make forecasts and predictions. It's a waste of time. All right. I can't even tell you what I'm going to have for dinner tomorrow night. How can I tell you what the market's going to be 6 or 8 months from now? It's a waste of time. Look, here's the reality. As I said, no one wants to sell down. No one wants to buy up. This market can go down 200 or 300 points more. The market can also go up 500 points. Either way, right now, part of the situation is active investors and traders are basically fully deployed. Probably 80 to 90% of their available investing days is in the market. They have not liquidated because prices haven't been going down. They haven't mm-hmm. been buying again because prices aren't going up. So it's just a matter of what breaks first. Now, everybody's looking at the COVID numbers, but we are almost reaching the point that what does it matter? All right, we have 7,000 or 8,000 cases today, and it'll be 12,000 tomorrow because of the errors in the data and the late reporting mm-hmm. and one thing and another. What it looks like to me, and nobody's going to like what I have to say, this virus has to burn itself out, or we have to have mass inoculation. And the way things are going right now, it doesn't look like we're going to have that max vaccination anytime soon, because we seem to have different government agencies on different pages of the playbook. Sorry to say that, but it's true. Right now, the only thing you can do is protect yourself, both health-wise and financially. So how long is it going to take? I do not have a clue. In the meantime, I'm not selling. I'm doing a little bit of buying. I'm trading the ranges, as you said. I'm trading movement. And we just have to let this thing play out. It's not going to last forever. Now, light at the end of the tunnel is we're seeing we are seeing earnings coming in that indicate once we get over this lockdown mania, business is going to boom. And that's what we're seeing from the fourth quarter revenue numbers. Now, sure, profits were down as to be expected. But revenue in the fourth quarter, you've had companies that have had tremendous bumps from the third quarter simply based on the fact that people were able to get out and shop and go to work and do all the normal things.
Okay. John, let's go over some interesting corporate stories that we have from this morning. Let's start with Converge ICT. Dennis Oi has signed a binding term sheet with Keppel from Singapore for the right to use one full fiber pair from the Trans-Pacific Bifrost cable system. Basically, this system is supposed to cover the Davao region. This is going to cost over $100 million. This Trans-Pacific Bifrost cable system is actually the world's first under-the-sea cable network that's supposed to connect Singapore to the West Coast. Essentially, faster internet, and which means faster deployment in Vismin as well. Converge ICT, looking good to you right now?
Well, it's fantastic. Our cat videos are going to download, what, 20% faster? Yeah, it's a good move. Converge is, internet speed is wonderful, and this link tie-up is great. But the bottom line is, Converge is going to stay where it is until you and I here in Metro Manila can use the system. I mean, I'm sorry, until you and I in Metro Manila have more capabilities on it. You go through complaints. You want to know what's happening in the world? Twitter, that's what it's all about. It used to be every other tweet was a complaint about PLD2. Now every other tweet is a complaint about Converge. And it all comes down to service. Yes, it's great. I love it. I'm glad Converge is doing this. But in terms of profitability, we have to wait and see. This is a very low margin business. So it depends on numbers of subscribers.
Okay, but so far investors seem to like it. Converge shares have gone up, at least above, breaking above its IPO 1680, now at 18-19 pesos. So I guess investors are feeling confident. How about this, John? SM Prime, the property unit of the Henry C. Empire, has named three new independent directors. And interesting personalities, you've got former Philippine BSP Governor Sy Tetangco, former Pag-ibig head Darlene Bedabe, and of course, Mr. Carlos Cruz, who is with SGV, I think, as new board members. Also still with SM Prime, they're allocating 80 billion pesos for CapEx this year. They're looking to open three new malls here in the Philippines. Quick comment.
Independent directors, pretty faces with no power. Look, the purpose of an independent director is to have somebody there to make sure that the existing directors are not going to make any scandalous mistakes. Because if the board goes down, the independent directors go down. It's wonderful. As far as opening new malls, that's what it should be. Three new malls, basically, I understand that they're in the NCR region. It's great. And they will make profit. And it's good to see companies like SM continuing to put money into the future. That is part of the light at the end of the economic tunnel.
There you go. And speaking of opening new businesses, Double Dragon of Injap Sia and Tony Tantakyong also opening three new Hotel 101 projects in the next three quarters. They're going to be located in Libis, Boracay, and Cebu. So another light there, glimmer of light at the end of the economic tunnel. And finally, the SEC, John, has given the green light to Mondnisin's rather 72.5 billion peso IPO. We're showing a breakdown there. They're looking to raise as much as 72.5 billion, offering 3.6 billion shares. The price is up to 17 pesos and 50 centavos per piece. The offer period is set between May 17 and 21, with listing on May 31st. Do you think that a name like this, Mondnisin, a very big manufacturer of big brands like Lucky Me Noodles, Skyflakes, for example, do you think this is going to be enough to entice more investors to get into the market, including the foreign investors?
All right, let's talk about this offering. What I look at in an offering is, where is the money going to be spent?
Ah, okay.
The bulk of the proceeds are going to go to retiring debt and redeeming the convertible bond. Now, only a little bit is going to go for capital expenditure, and that's where growth comes from.
Okay.
Lucky Me, number one in the Philippines. So where's the growth? I mean, I'm not going to go out and eat an extra Lucky Me noodle because of the IPO. You've got corn, which is number one in the UK. Where's the growth? They said in the prospectus that they're coming out with dinosaur-shaped fake chicken to appeal to children, but that's not a growth. That's not a growth market. You look at the U.S. They own about 10% of the market in the U.S. for fake meat, but the U.S. doesn't want fake chicken. They want fake burgers. So again, I'm going to say, first, they're spending the money to reduce debt. That'll improve the balance sheet. But where is the corporate profit growth going to come from? I don't see it.
John, just wanted to add to what you said. They did give a breakdown from the $72 billion gross proceeds. They're looking about $60 billion net proceeds, $26.5 billion for CapEx, a relatively small portion, $17.3 billion, what you mentioned, redeeming convertible notes, and another $17 billion to repay loans. Okay, speaking of retail, John, here's an interesting story from China. Delivery giant Meituan, also China's third largest internet company, has raised a record $10 billion from a top-up placement and convertible bond sales as it tries to double down on fighting giants like Alibaba in online grocery segment. More than the boom in online shopping, what's interesting, John, is how crises like this sort of level the playing field, not entirely, but in some ways, that gives new competitors a chance to break in and play with the big boys. Are you seeing the same trend or opportunity here in the Philippines? I mean, personally, I haven't been hearing these names that have, you know, sprouted up during the pandemic, competing with the big players. It's still the same big names.
Well, look, in China, the playing field with Alibaba is being done by the government, okay?
Okay.
The unluckiest person on earth right now is Jack Ma.
He's Jack Ma.
I mean, the poor guy can't do Alibaba. They're kicking him out of Ant. I guess he can probably feel fortunate that he's not in a prison someplace. But you can't make any comparisons between what happens in the business environment in China because the government decides the winners and the losers. All right, here in the Philippines, you got three kinds of companies in the Philippines right now. You've got companies that are disaster areas like Cebu Pacific with their earnings, with their revenues and profits because of the pandemic. You've got companies that took advantage, or I don't mean that in a negative sense. I mean, they profited from the pandemic. And you can talk about Century Tuna, you can talk about Pure Gold. I mean, they happen to be at the right place at the right time. And then there's companies that took a hit that just kept on the course and are going to come back over the next 12 months. Now, new names in the Philippines, I can't think of any new names that have profited from the... Oh, yeah, I know a lot of new names because on Facebook, every other ad is buy my bread, buy my pancit, buy my...
but these are small players.
Doesn't matter. They're small players today, but they could become big players in the in the future because what this has done... And here again, Facebook and Twitter is the economy and the social structure. What you're seeing that companies that had, you know, their little restaurant in Antipolo has suddenly started selling by delivery, and who knows where they're going to be in a few years. Look, every large company started out small, and obviously the best example is Chow King. You know, we went from selling one hot dog to selling everybody in the country hot dogs.
Okay. So looking forward to hear more of these growth stories, maybe in a few months' time or in years when we all look back at this pandemic and how it's changed business. John, we've come to the most exciting part of this conversation, the blind item. Talk to us about the stock that you're liking and that you're monitoring closely. Don't tell us, just describe. So what do you have for us? Why are you liking this stock?
Okay. This is a company that fits into one of those three that I just talked about.
Mm-hmm.
Companies that had a reduction in revenues and earnings, but still made money. Now, to give you an example, they're in a sector, they're in a business sector that everybody anticipated for 2020 would be dead and buried. But the truth of the matter is that business sector did not come off as badly as everybody expected. What we saw in this sector was a reduction of about 40% on average of income. but they still made money. And this company in particular, I'm estimating that their profit for 2020 is probably down about 20-25% against the industry being down about 40%. The other reason I like it, and there's several companies also like this that intended to change their core business model for 2020, but couldn't because of the pandemic. And moving forward, this company is going to have a better revenues and better profitability because of that. Now, in terms of some numbers for those people that really love the fundamentals, based on what I see as the 2020 earnings, the price earnings ratio is less than 4.
Wow.
They're about 20% below the 52-week high, about 20% above the 52-week low, and the book value on it is almost 5 times the price of the stock. So when you look at these kinds of ratios and the fact that they had a reduction of earnings but not a loss in 2020, once we start opening up, I keep saying that, don't I? Once we start opening up, I see this as a company that's really going to improve dramatically by the end of the year.
Okay, we're just going to have to guess which stock this is to enjoy the dramatic upside. John, always a pleasure to speak with you. Thank you so much for joining us. Do stay safe.
Thank you, Michelle.